Last week we went to Liverpool. This week we meet apprentices of quite a different kind. Or are they? These are the fifth year boys of the Royal Ballet School at Richmond, near London. There are 40 boys at the school, aged between 11 and 16. Though competition to enter is very fierce, and part of the timetable is unusual, in most ways the school is just a school.
The next program, Music in...
Here's an announcement for teachers. The BBC is anxious to receive teachers' views on programmes in the series which follow this announcement. If you'd like to help, we'd be most grateful if you'd ring support services on 01992 5522, or in Scotland 041 332 4028, or in Wales 0222 869 444. Or you can write to Support Services, P.O. Box 7, London, W3. And now here's your programme.
In this programme, two young soldiers, born and bred in the Salvation Army, tell us what they feel about their organisation. The Salvation Army was founded more than 100 years ago as a Christian mission. The friendly nickname for it to this day is the Sally Ann.
I'm Leslie Dent, I'm 16 years old and I live in Southall, Middlesex.
I've got a sister called Mandy, who's 13, and a brother called Tony, who's 10. We're all in the Salvation Army, along with my mum and dad.
My name is Neil Hudson, and I'm 15. I live in Halifax, which is in West Yorkshire. All my family attend this Salvation Army, my mother, father, and my brother Paul, who's 13. I've attended...
Wildlife on One at 8 o'clock tomorrow evening explores the reasons for the demise of the red squirrel, which has now completely disappeared from most English counties. And by the way, there's an article about red squirrels in the March edition of the BBC Wildlife magazine with this colourful hummingbird on the cover.
Oi, 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 stop shopping. Look, right, the important thing I've been told to get across to you lot in this trail is that, hello, Mum, 10:20, BBC Two, Monday nights, is a new comedy series and it's live, live. Look, underline, live. Unlike this, which isn't.
Hello, Mum.
Oh, very good.
On BBC One now, four contestants from London and the South East compete for a place in the semi-finals of Mastermind. And from Mastermind to Masterclass here on BBC Two, given by the world-famous tenor Luciano Pavarotti.
Western society as sophisticated as we like to think, or have the answers to the problems of living been around for a long time? Do traditional societies share the same loyalties, the same conflicts, the same beliefs in law and order? And why do some people reject the rules of society, while others happily follow age-old rituals? Ray Gosling answers these questions in the new series of Human Jigsaw, starting soon on ITV.
Well, next this afternoon, Audrey Hepburn and Albert Finney star in the Sunday matinee Two for the Road, a light-hearted story of a couple that takes a perceptive look over their 12 years of marriage.
You were committed to the leading automatic powder until you tried dyes in your hot whites wash. What were your results?
Well, these socks, they had sand all over them. I mean, look at that. I mean, you can't beat that, can you? Also, this is Matthew's shirt, drinks and chocolate. It was filthy. I mean, look at that, bright and white. I thought it was very good value for money. Cost less. Obviously, when you bring a family up, that's very important.
So will you swap your packet of dyes for two packets of your old powder?
No way. No. No, thank you.
Why not?
Because I'm really pleased with the Daz whiteness. Daz is great. I'll stick with it.
Try Daz yourself in the hot whites wash. Most women agree Daz gives unbeatable white at a price that's right.
The race to the White House has always been long and hard. And along the way, it sure helps to find the right running mate.
Howdy, Mr. Lincoln. Perky's the name. Henry D. Perky.
Beat it, Buster. I'm busy.
But, Mr. Lincoln, my new shredded wheat cereal has all the bran fiber of 100% whole wheat.
You don't say.
No added salt nor sugar neither.
So?
So two's fine if you're running for a bus. But since you're running for president...
Three shredded wheat?
Mm-hmm.
Gee, thanks, Perky. The hat's mighty fine, too. Shredded wheat, the original bran fiber cereal.
Hey, Mum, are you throwing away my trainers? They're almost new.
Well, they smell old. I'm going to wear them on the windowsill for a month. Or we're going to start using Super Tough Odor Eaters.
Super Tough Odor Eaters insoles for trainers contain millions of particles of activated charcoal to absorb perspiration and destroy foot and trainer odor.
Thanks, Mum. My trainers don't smell like trainers anymore.
Super Tough Odor Eaters for trainers and regular odor eaters for ordinary shoes.
After school, we played football. Dad said he could have played for United, but he married Mum instead. He said the old magic was still there, but Mum called half-time and gave us all a Milky Way. Milky Way is really ace. It's milk chocolate on the outside and all whipped up fluffy and light in the middle. Later, Dad showed us some fancy footwork. We could see he hadn't lost his touch, but we decided it was time for tea. Yippee!
Milky Way, the sweets you can eat between meals without ruining your appetite. Everything you wear says something about the kind of woman you are. That's why the perfume you choose is Tweed. Because wherever you are and whoever you're with, Tweed says just what you want it to say, right through the day and longer. Tweed Parfum de Toilette Spray, the finishing touch.
I'd say both victim and killer had a taste for the finer things in life.
How do you know that, miss?
Well, our late friend was enjoying Mother's Pride Sultana scones, whilst the murderess finished off the raisin and bran scones.
Couldn't you murder a Mother's Pride scone?
There's a heavy, hot monster burning the ground. He's so hot, he drank a river down.
Big thirst.
Nothing could quench his big, bad thirst. Like a lake? Well, man, that only made it worse.
Big, bad thirst.
One day, he knocked back a swimming pool. Then he got a taste of something real cool.
Big new squash!
Now, if you follow my jive and get hip to my verse, only quash can quench the...
Big, bad thirst.
Big new quash!
Finding a magazine that appeals to all the family is as easy as 1, 2, 3. Page the Oracle. The magazine on the screen.
Sunday means entertainment here on Granada. 7:15 brings the game for gamblers, winner takes all, with Jimmy Tarbuck inviting contestants to place their bets and go for the jackpot. At 7:45, Murder, She Wrote.
Now go away!
Our good wishes will be with you always.
First, we must go to the federal authorities and ask them to seek asylum.
The Dangers of Defection at 7:45, and at 9, Connie moves out.
Gone.
There is something with you that I need, but with me, that's always been the reason for chucking it. I'll see you, pal, and never looking back.
10 brings a threatening call in Tales of the Unexpected.
I wish you hadn't got this job.
Why, do you think it made much difference to us?
Partly that.
What else?
I'm afraid.
And with Jimmy Young at 10:30 and the late-night movie Nightmare at 11:15, this is Sunday here on Granada.
Well, now on Granada, Audrey Hepburn and Albert Finney star in the Sunday Matinee, a light-hearted story of a couple that takes a perceptive look over their 12 years of marriage. Two for the road.
The Allegheny Hills, the air was split with the sound of wheels. It was Stanley Stope and his brother Irvine with a brand new fruit drink named a Moonshine. Well, then no good critters hit the road, and up jumped one Nathaniel Toad. He took a swig and then he smiled. Oh, the fruits in this here stuff is wild.
Moonshine, moonshine, looks great. We're gonna taste this fine. We'll ship this load from County Line. Only in the boys will be doing time.
You tell us how much you like the Alpen taste, but couldn't we make it cheaper? Well, we could cut down on our fruit, not go such a bundle. Our wheat, lose the odd nut or two, or add to the cheaper ingredients. But we think you'd notice the difference. That's why we keep to the Swiss recipe we prefer, so you keep the Alpen taste you prefer. Alpen. It's not the tastiest muesli for nothing.
It's looking good, Mr. McEnroe.
What are you, a comedian?
I meant your shave. It's very close.
Of course. I shave with Bic.
Yes, I've seen the commercial.
It's all true. Bic is beautiful, smooth, close, comfortable. How Bic does it beats me.
And where do you spend all the money you save, Mr. McEnroe?
Tennis lessons.
Bic, the shave that saves.
The living beauty of wood is one of the greatest assets in your home. So Cupronol have developed a range of varnishes with a special high-build formula that gives you more shine, fewer coats. So with each coat, you can see the difference as Cupronol builds to a deep finish of lasting shine that's as tough as it looks. More shine, fewer coats in gloss matte or satin. Cupronol varnishes from the Cupronol Woodworker range. All you need to shine at woodwork.
as I stroll along me garden, all I can see is kind of sparse. It lacks a certain class, there ain't a lot of grass. So I gives me wrist a little twist, and I feeds the bits that are always missed, and I makes me lawn the envy of me neighbours.
Spear and Jackson Lawn Booster. Spread it, water it in, and see the improvement in only a few weeks.
It makes me lawn the envy of me neighbours.
The Larder Reaver. Try one for size.
Compliments, the man in the corner.
Interesting.
The man in the corner?
It's different. What is it?
You approve.
You mean the drink? Yes, I like it. It's unusual. Tasty. So what is it?
Tico, a new kind of sherry that you mix.
Mix? So whose idea is that?
Harvey's.
Tell your friend Harvey. It's got great taste.
Tico, you may not like the idea, but you'll love the taste. Tonight's programme can be seen again on Sunday afternoon at 2:50 here on BBC Two. Tomorrow, Your Life in Their Hands returns with a new series and opens with the topical subject of liver transplants as Susan Smith undergoes a life-saving operation.
Susan is lucky. The shortage of donor livers means that half the patients waiting for a transplant die before a liver becomes available. At 8:20 in the morning, Professor Khan starts. Susan's transplant will be the 15th he's done in the past year.
The first ever televised liver transplant in Your Life in Their Hands, tomorrow at 9:30 on BBC Two. And now on BBC Two, the first part of a specially recorded concert from the Theatre Royal Bury St Edmunds, featuring the legendary musicians from New Orleans, the Preservation Hall Jazz Band.
Care and attention.
K-Y-L-E. Kyle. Starting next Monday here on 2, a new series. Jack Headley stars in a romantic thriller, Who Pays the Ferryman? Alan Haldane, searching for an identity, returns to Crete after an absence of some 30 years.
I think I am looking for something.
Something you found here and then you lost?
Perhaps. I must meet her.
But why? As far as Eleanor is concerned, Senos Papadakis was her father. After all these years, you cannot turn up a stranger from England and tell her the truth.
I wasn't going to tell her anything, but I must meet her and I must talk to her.
No.
The Englishman must be driven from Crete. And if he will not go, well then, you know what must be done.
Jack Headley stars as Alan Haldane, a man at the center of a vendetta, a dramatic story set against a background of romance and fear in Crete. A new series, Who Pays the Ferryman, starts next Monday at 9 here on 2. And now on BBC Two, Ronald Eyre continues to follow man's search for a meaning to his existence. On Thursday evening on Radio 3, and the Amadeus Quartet can be seen playing the whole of Beethoven's String Quartet, Opus 135, part of which was included in tonight's Long Search, at 11:35 this evening here on 2. And in 10 minutes, this week's Open Door programme has been made by the British Field Sports Society and the Masters of the Fox Hounds Association, who present their own view on hunting the wild fox. First, Peter Woods with the late news on 2.
The pound has been revalued by new moves from the Bank of England. The government's decision to allow the pound to float upwards against the dollar and other currencies lifted sterling to its highest level for 18 months tonight. But the Treasury's change of tactics after months of deliberately holding the pound's value down is causing concern to some exporters. Mr. John Methven, the CBI's Director General, said he wasn't pleased with the government's decision. Moderate pay settlements were now more essential than ever if industry was to maintain competitive prices abroad. But Sir Geoffrey Howe, the opposition Shadow Chancellor, welcomed the move and said the government had done exactly what the Shadow Cabinet had said they should do. Tonight, the pound closed at $1.84, up 6.25 cents. That's an effective revaluation of 3.5%. And against other currencies, it also improved to stand at 64.6% of its 1971 value. Richard Whitmore asked a foreign exchange dealer what effect the rising pound has had on the money markets.
Well, it's created an extremely busy market, but it's been a good two-way market. There have been plenty of buyers and plenty of sellers, but as the rate has gone up from the opening by about 1 cent, clearly there have been more buyers of sterling than sellers. The Bank of England, I suspect, will have smoothed out the operations and taken in just a few here and there. But I don't think there's been any concerted Bank of England operation at all today.
Well, at the moment, as you close here, it's reached, what, 184?
Yes.
Do you expect it to go higher tomorrow?
Yes, I suspect that it will continue to get firmer unless the Bank of England take a big interest in the market and intervene heavily. But I don't think that at this level that they're likely to do that.
But at what height would things become more critical then?
Well, this is very difficult to say, but I would suspect it can go to 186 without perhaps the Bank of England taking very much interest.
British Leyland's car workers have voted nearly 2-1 to accept the company's plans to reform wage bargaining. The result of a secret ballot was 59,000 votes for the reform package and 31,000 against. It's a complicated package involving an immediate 10% pay rise as the first step towards a company-wide agreement. There'd also be parity, so workers will get the same wage for the same job everywhere. Security through better sick and layoff pay, and bonus schemes for production at each plant. And within 2 years, the central bargaining unit to negotiate for the whole of Leyland Cars, not the present 58 units. Different aspects of the scheme have attracted different people. Did Leyland think central bargaining was the answer to the company's problems?
We're not saying that'll be the total answer, but it will be the answer to so many of our difficulties. Something like two-thirds of our disputes have consistently been in this whole area of pay and security and looking across at other plants and other employees in other plants.
The tragedy will be if we are not able to take, for example, the November date, the 10% increase, and the first down payment on parity to its logical conclusion, because that's what everyone has voted for. And no one should be under any illusions about the situation that if they don't come forward with those goods, the psychological reaction on our people, not only here but through the whole of Leyland Cars, will be destructive.
Shop stewards representing the 3,000 manual workers on unofficial strike at British Oxygen have tonight recommended a return to work. Mr. John Miller, the Transport Workers' National Chemical Officer, said the company had made a fairly substantial new offer. But voting was close, 38 in favour, 36 against. Further talks are planned on Thursday after the men at 46 depots around the country have been consulted. The Police Federation have accepted the government's pay offer. The Federation's executive, representing 100,000 police officers in England and Wales, agreed to accept the pay offer of 10% backdated to September, plus an independent inquiry into pay and conditions. Federations in Scotland and Northern Ireland also agreed. The Home Secretary has given an undertaking that he'll accept the conclusions of the inquiry. And the Home Secretary has also seen leaders of the Firemen's Union and their employers. But his surprise move doesn't seem to have bridged the gap between them on pay. The firemen have been offered 10%, they want 30%, and may strike if they don't get it. At the United Nations, America, Britain and France tonight vetoed proposals by African members in the Security Council for stiff sanctions against South Africa. Among other things, the rejected proposals would have banned arms shipments to South Africa and halted foreign investment. One resolution was adopted, strongly condemning South Africa for repressing the black majority and calling for the release of those detained for their opposition to apartheid. Now Rhodesia, and Lord Carver, the man chosen under the Anglo-American peace plan to serve as resident commissioner during the transition to majority rule, has had his first round of talks with African leaders. Lord Carver, in the Tanzanian capital, has had a meeting with Mr. Nkomo and Mr. Mugabe, the leaders of the Patriotic Front. From Dar es Salaam, Martin Bell reports.
Of this latest British mission to Africa, the least that can be said is that the show is on the road. Nobody walked out. The Patriotic Front leaders agreed to a later meeting with Lord Carver's team at a date to be announced, and Mr. Nkomo, who was acting as spokesman, was uncharacteristically restrained in his comments afterwards. He came out onto the steps of the High Commissioner's house with Mr. Mugabe, General Chand, and Lord Carver, who was dressed in his Field Marshal uniform. The one exchange the Patriotic Front leader repeated there for us was about the powers Lord Carver would have as the new Commissioner, powers, Mr. Nkomo said, that no person on the globe had ever had. The Patriotic Front here were repeating an old objection that the Anglo-American plan was an attempt to recolonize Rhodesia. But did they even accept Lord Carver's status as commissioner-designate? Before the talks, I put this to Mr. Mugabe.
I recognize Lord Carver as Dr. Owen's messenger. He's brought a message from Dr. Owen, and in that capacity, well, naturally, he's coming to deliver whatever this message might be, and we'll look at him as a British emissary.
Do you think there is any point negotiating about a ceasefire?
Ceasefire? Well, we haven't agreed on the setup during the transitional period, and also the proposals regarding the independence period have not been agreed. We have.
Sat in the nude by the mirror and picked out a rose from a bouquet in our home.
This England Next Friday goes to a health farm for a slimline tonic. Next tonight, though, the new Avengers penetrate a forward base.
The British Academy Awards, introduced by Michael...
Take an exciting glimpse into the future at Enterprise Northwest, 7th to 16th of March. Don't miss Enterprise Northwest, the first exhibition at Manchester's new GMEX Centre.
Cadbury's new Caprice biscuits are made with real ingredients. Chopped hazelnuts and ground ginger. Oil of almond with natural honey. Zest of orange. With waves of Cadbury's Dairy Milk Chocolate. New Cadbury's Caprice Biscuits. You can't mistake the real ingredients.
Today brought you the news in colour. Were you ready for today?
I was ready.
I was ready.
I'm not ready!
Today, the first newspaper in colour 7 days a week. Order your today, today.
If you're interested in how much fat you eat, here are two ways to eat sausages with half the fat of ordinary sausages. One is to eat Boyer's low-fat sausages made with half the fat and extra lean pork. The other is to eat half the ordinary sausages.
Boyer's low-fat sausages, available fresh and frozen.
Sing a song of sixpence, the king he gave some. He wasn't even partial. Two blackbirds in a pie. But when the pie was opened, much to his surprise, his favorite Cadbury's buttons were right before his eyes.
Must be lunchtime. Come here, Pterosaurus.
Hold it, Rex. Here's something even tastier than me. New Spaghettisaurus. Look, there's Blunty and me. And who's the good-looking one? Oh, it's you, Rex. Yeah. All in the tasty tomato sauce. New Spaghettisaurus from Cross and Blackwell. Eat them before they eat you.
Country Homes and Interiors is a new magazine. For the kind of woman who thinks that flowers don't simply belong in vases. Who enjoys looking at houses more when she knows who lives in them. Who loves antiques, especially when she's paid yesterday's prices. Who never stole a design idea without improving it. Who believes clinical kitchens belong in clinics. Who speaks of food and friendship in the same breath. Who loves the country look even when she's not in the country. New Country Homes and Interiors, for the kind of houses you'd leave home for.
Thank you.
Mummy. Come and see Mummy. Come and see Mummy. Come on.
Hey, I love you, boy. Come on. Come and see Mummy. Come and see
Mummy. How was it?
Great. Did you get me cards?
Yeah. Well, tell us then.
Well, we went to Devon and Somerset, Exmoor. We did 8 youth hostels. You thought my mum...
I'm a gonna raise a fuss, I'm a gonna raise a holler. About a working all summer just to try to earn a dollar. Every time I call my baby, try to get a date. My boss says,
no dice, son, you gotta work late.
Sometimes I wonder what I'm a gonna do, but there ain't no cure for the summertime blues.
It's 3 o'clock. Songs of Praise from Abbey Wood in southeast London is the next programme on BBC One, and that's at 3:15. In the meantime, we're returning to a trade test transmission.
Banks and High Street simply disappeared under the water.
Not even the sun trying to break through the clouds today in North Wales could compensate for the damage already caused by flooding. In Dalgathley, the fire station was put out of action and 2 cars were left abandoned. A combination of high tide and torrential rain caused the Onion River in Gwynedd to burst its bank. The picturesque town of Dalgathley has never known anything quite like this for a long time. At one stage, police warned of imminent danger of the town being cut off.
It's the worst flooding that we've experienced in Dalgathley since sometime in the 60s. It was the very, very heavy rainfall during yesterday and throughout the night, plus the tide this morning. There was a fairly high tide at about 7 o'clock this morning, and this totally flooded the town and the estuary.
But the tide has since gone down, hasn't it?
It has gone down very rapidly from about 11 o'clock this morning.
How about casualties and losses?
Well, we have not evaluated this yet, and obviously there will be some losses and damage in the area.
Further north, a third stage alert was declared in the Conwy Valley as the Conwy River burst its bank, flooding low-lying farms. In the town of Clanhoust, hedges were washed away and many of the roads were left under several feet of water, levels rising almost to the top goalpost of the local football pitch. But despite the rain and the high tide, some took advantage of the ever-present high winds to do some high-speed sailing. Many in North Wales will remember this as the night the rain came down and the floods went up.
The River Ethro burst its banks at Glossop, where the normally busy A57 was flooded to a depth of 3 feet. Local residents were alerted to danger as firemen strove to hold back the water and police diverted traffic. The North West Water Authority called out extra staff to monitor the level of other rivers, including the Irwell and the Mersey, and reservoirs were checked for fear of contamination from swollen streams. As the height of the rivers rose by more than 4 feet in stretches, floodgates were opened in Greater Manchester to reduce risk to land and buildings. More than an inch of rain was recorded in Manchester overnight, and that's a quarter of the total rainfall for the whole of the month until yesterday.
And the swollen River Irwell may have claimed a victim when a youth who was being chased by police tried to cross the river at Stacksteads near Bacup last night. The youth, aged about 17, fled after being challenged by 2 police officers who saw him riding an unregistered motorcycle. The youth, whose identity is still a mystery, was swept away. It's feared he may have drowned. Police will resume their search for him when the river subsides. The EEC Environment Commissioner has back...
Programmes featuring jazz musicians and their music.
At 8:20, a concert recorded at the Bath International Festival starring Loose Tubes, one of the most innovative of young British orchestras whose members include classical, pop and full-time jazz musicians. Jazz Sounds 86 at 9:15 features performances from the five finalists in the Young Jazz Band competition, which attracted over 90 entries. At 11, a 31-piece orchestra put together by Rolling Stones drummer Charlie Watts plays one of its occasional concerts in a celebration of jazz. Sven Klang's quintet at midnight is the highly acclaimed Swedish film which follows the fortunes of a group gigging in small towns in the 1950s. And this is how those programmes fit into a whole evening of jazz starting at 7:25 tonight on BBC Two.
Now on to Newsview with Jan Leeming and Moira Stewart.
Headlines tonight. Scottish miners fight to save their pit from fire. 49 people are killed as a Brazilian airliner crashes in Africa. And England's cricketers continue their winning ways against West Indies.
The headlines of the week, the death of Lord Stockton, the fire tragedy in Puerto Rico, and the safe return of Samantha Etteridge.
British Coal is confident the underground fire at Seafield Colliery in Scotland will soon be contained. The main coal face opened only
With well over 100 Seafield miners responding to the appeal, the colliery management couldn't have sent them all down at once to fight the fire. So the rescue brigades are working in shifts, 50 men at a time, to seal off the roadway where the fire first started. It's cost British Coal more than £8 million in the last year to open two new faces, and with one lost, it's a race against time to save their investment.
I would pay tribute to men who have returned from what should be a holiday to help us at this time. Of course, they are looking after their own job potential in the future, and it doesn't surprise me that people will respond to what they know is a real request for assistance.
Underground, the rescue teams have sealed off the fire by erecting specially prepared concrete walls. When fires caused the loss of two faces here during the miners' strike, the hope was that the new investment would secure the jobs of the 800 men left. This weekend's blow means 40% of the available coal has been lost, but management are now optimistic they can increase production on the face which is being saved. An added irony to the fire risk below is the weather overhead. If the barometer stays high, that's good news for fighting the fire, because any sudden change in the weather will change the atmosphere underground, and that could fan the flames again.
49 passengers and crew aboard a Brazilian airliner were killed when it crashed in the West African state of Ivory Coast. It crashed at Banjaville, 11 miles from Abidjan, while attempting to return to the airport. The plane came down in an area of dense forest shortly after the pilot had said he was emptying the fuel tank to prepare for an emergency landing. It took French soldiers from a nearby army base an hour to find the crash site. Medical teams took even longer to arrive. One of the two men who survived was from Ivory Coast, the other was thought to be a Brazilian. The storms which have been battering the east coast of the United States are now moving northwards towards Canada. The combination of high tides and strong winds have left a trail of destruction and at least 15 people dead.
The high seas have pounded the eastern seaboard over hundreds of miles, costing millions in damage. The worst storm for nearly a decade, overrunning flood barriers and causing mass evacuations in five states. Weather experts blamed a rare alignment of the Earth, Moon and Sun and promised it wouldn't happen again for 15 years. Little comfort to the thousands who left their homes and lost their property. In some areas, special shelters had been set up, but by this morning, many were able to return home. Where there'd been seawater, they found snow. The storm had dumped as much as 17 inches inland. And in the northeast, traffic accidents caused the death of at least 9 people. The forecast, though, is for a better new year, with the sun and the moon now ready to look more kindly on the earth.
President Reagan has returned to Washington after the Christmas holidays, his presidency still beset by difficulties. Apart from the investigation into the Iranian arms scandal, there's likely to be opposition to the administration's budget proposals. And tomorrow, Mr. Reagan enters hospital for an operation on his prostate. Asked on holiday if he was worried, the president put on a brave face.
Really, what I'm going in for is kind of a breeze. I've been there before, so don't waste any sympathy. I don't feel ill at all.
When the president and Mrs. Reagan arrived back in Washington, one resident of the White House couldn't contain his joy at their return. And if all goes to plan, the president should be out of hospital by the end of the week. In France, it's been another day of disruption on the railways, with only about one in four mainline trains running. At the Gare de Lyon in Paris, CRS riot police were on hand to prevent strikers from blocking the lines. Half the normal number of TGV high-speed trains to the southeast were operating. A bomb has exploded outside an office in Johannesburg, injuring a woman. The bomb was planted in a flower bed and went off early this afternoon. In Botswana, the authorities are investigating a grenade and bomb attack at the border town of Ramotswa. A civilian died and five soldiers were injured. The civilian was a woman of 72. The soldiers were hurt by a delayed action bomb in her ruined house. Botswana blames South Africa. In South Africa itself, a policeman murdered by a suspected ANC guerrilla has been buried. The sergeant, a married man of 43, was shot near the Zimbabwe border last week. A 14-year-old boy was due to appear in court at Swindon this evening, charged with rape and burglary. The charges relate to an attack on a woman of 27 who was raped in front of her 5-year-old son at her home on New Year's Eve. Steelworkers opposing the government's decision to close the Gartcosh steelworks in Scotland have been on the march again. Last year, 11 marchers walked from Motherwell in Lanarkshire to London to make their protest. Today, they marked the anniversary of the closure. Led by a pipe band and followed by several hundred supporters, the marchers covered a shorter distance to the Ravenscraig steelworks. The organisers say they intend to keep up the pressure on the government to boost investment in the Scottish steel industry. From midnight tonight, the cost of crossing the Severn Bridge is going up by 150%. The Department of Transport has been trying to implement the increase for a year. Haulage contractors who use the bridge between England and Wales regularly say the rise will badly affect their business costs.
It cost half a crown to cross the Severn Bridge when it opened in 1966. 10 years later, the toll went up to 20 pence for cars, 40 pence for lorries. In 1985, they went up again to 50 pence on a pound. County councils in South Wales took legal action and the new tolls were suspended. But the Court of Appeal ruled in favour of the Department of Transport. Tonight, the tolls go up and haulage contractors are very angry.
What I can't understand is why we're going to pay tolls at all. I think the whole system should be abolished because we pay enough taxes to keep our vehicles on the road without having to pay any more tolls for it.
15 million cars and lorries crossed the Severn Bridge last year. And it's unlikely that many of them will take the 50-mile detour through Gloucester rather than pay the extra toll.
The governments of Cyprus and Lebanon have protested strongly to the Israeli authorities over what they say is a blockade by Israel of regular sea links between their two countries. The protest follows yesterday's interception by an Israeli naval gunboat of a regular ferry from Cyprus to Junieh in northern Lebanon. The ship was forced to turn round and is now stranded with its passengers in Larnaca. The Israelis allege that the route has been used to smuggle Palestinian terrorists into
Lebanon. We're making this line regularly, 3.5 years now, with the same ship. I have no terrorists on board. And also that's confirmed by the immigration officers of Larnaca on board.
Living in Lebanon, you learn to expect the unexpected. And when we saw there was a gunboat following the boat, we thought perhaps they had been wise to turn back.
And now with today's sport, beginning with another victory for England's cricketers, here's David Icke.
England's cricketing success in Australia continues. After retaining the Ashes, they've now reached the final of the one-day competition, the Perth Challenge, by beating the West Indies in a memorable match. England scored 228 in their 50 overs. Then, as man of the match, Graham Dilley took four wickets. They dismissed the West Indies to win by 19 runs. Michael Peshart reporting.